All right, welcome back to Round Rock 2. I'm Dave Vellante here with Rob Strechay and Drew Schulke, who's here as the Vice President of Product Management at Dell. Drew, good to see you again.
Great to see you guys.
Thanks
We're not at Dell Tech
time.
World. In our domain now, this
we'll
is nice.
Be soon.
Yeah.
Looking forward to
well,
that.
Well, we're actually in person because we were on, you know, recently.
Virtually, that's right.
Virtually.
So. Yeah, thanks for coming in.
So not much going on out there, is there?
No.
We've got a new administration, a lot of business momentum. Yeah, there's some uncertainty out there, but one thing's definitely certain is that customers are leaning all in on modernizing their infrastructure. They're doing a lot more stuff on-prem with their private clouds. What are the big trends you're seeing, Drew?
Yeah, I'd say let's maybe start with sort of that private hybrid cloud landscape. Mm-hmm. There's been some interesting, I'll call it dynamics in the ecosystem over the past year, which has really created, in my mind, a brand new inflection point as we think about infrastructure and how we choose to consume it, you know, in the data center. And maybe let's like wind back the clock maybe 20 years ago. Three-tier architecture, right? Everybody, that's what everybody was using. I got some storage, I got some network, I got some compute. And they lived in the silos. And you know, we came along with solutions like converged infrastructure, which is like, well, how do we take some of the unpredictability out of that, but kind of package it up together? But HCI came on this, hyperconverged infrastructure came on the scene. That was sort of the last inflection point that we saw. And it helped collapse the silos, you know, via the way it was deploying and kind of bringing that compute and storage elements together. And it opened up the ability for our customers to have brand new operating models. So like I could actually, with this technology, bust down those silos and think about, okay, maybe I need to reimagine my resources and how I keep this infrastructure up. And so that presented a tremendous opportunity. And so as an industry, we've seen that take hold and get a lot of traction over the past 10 years. But we believe firmly we're at like the next inflection point of that. And, you know, what we're seeing as the, you know, the model that people are starting to evolve to, we're referring to this as, you know, a disaggregated architecture. And some people might say, well, that's just kind of like a throwback to the three-tier. Well, not really, and I'll talk about why, but like why is this coming as an inflection point? I'll kind of point out the two things. One is that, you know, clearly the move to hyperconvergence, you know, in the midst of all those operational benefits, you had to have, I'll call it an ecosystem affinity. Like you were, you know, I was in a VMware ecosystem or a Microsoft ecosystem, et cetera, right? And look, things have happened over the past year that, you know, customers are like, well, maybe I want some more flexibility here. And by the way, that also means besides an ecosystem affinity, it's like in bare metal workloads, what's your answer for that? We never really crack that nut in HCI. So there's kind of like that dynamic. And the other thing I'd say going along with it, and it's somewhat related, is, you know, to the extent that I'm getting, you know, the most bang for the buck out of the resources that I bought. And look, we've been the leader in HCI infrastructure for a long time. We've got lots of data from how our customers are using it. And one thing is clear is that in that particular model, you know, CPU utilization tends to run lower than in the disaggregated architecture. Why is that important? Well, yeah, you want to get the bang for the buck, but look at the way licensing schemes are evolving with subscriptions, yeah. And it's all per core. So it's like, well, if I want to be paying for software on the core, boy, I want to be getting, you know, the most, you know, cycles and performance I can out of each and every core. And so that's where we see this disaggregated, you know, architecture taking hold, is let's decouple the storage and compute, allow us to maximize each. By the way, I can refresh each of those then on the cycle that they need to refresh and when it makes sense. And with everything going on right now on the compute side of the house, its cadence of refresh is certainly at a much faster pace. So we're kind of unleash that. But then I'd say, you know, in addition though, beyond that is like, how do we bring the operational model to it? Like, so that was the last inflection point. We changed the operational model. And this is where we're focused. It's not just kind of like, hey, we're decoupling these things. Because we have so much of that experience on the hyperconverged side, we're bringing that in through, you know, an automation platform that, you know, we're going to be talking a lot about at Dell Tech World coming up, about how do we maintain that operational simplicity, but in an architecture that allows us to have that optimization at that computer.
I like how you went back 20 years ago, because 20 years ago, I would also point out that the main cost was human labor.
Yes.
And the whole move to HCI addressed that with simplicity. And you're absolutely right now. software license costs are a much, much higher component of the overall cost than they were before. So we've That's attacked right. the human labor problem and created a new problem.
I think what's also interesting is HCI created kind of another problem, which was, and I think this goes to your disaggregated comment, where it was scale up or scale out. It was really scale out. And there was no scale, the scale up compartment, you know, portion of it was really difficult at that point in time. And I know Dell's doing stuff on that side of the house as well. But there's also the fact that to bring in a new technology, you pretty much had to swap out or buy yet another thing. You guys are doing stuff with like QLC and other stuff in PowerStore. That has to be another driver from a cost and efficiency perspective as well as energy perspective for your end users.
Yeah, completely. So like PowerStore is going to play a critical role in this disaggregated architecture that I'm talking about, just given its applicability across use cases and verticals and so forth. And to your point on the economics of it, data efficiency, like I can't overstate this, like the single most impactful way you can influence your cost of storing that data is through data efficiency. Better deduplication, better compression, it's the gift that keeps on giving in lowering that total cost of ownership of storing your data. And by the way, that total cost of ownership extends into the power and the cooling and the physical footprint, because like I've got fewer disks, I've got fewer systems at the end of the day because we're able to go off and do that. So you'll continue to see us lean heavily into that. We made a big deal at last year's Dell Tech World about our 5-to-1 guarantee, no questions asked. I think it's recognized in the industry as best in class for that. We think there's headroom for that and improvement. We're not done yet in terms of what we can do in software. So, you know, we're going to keep pushing on that side. But that is kind of, you know, where it all begins. Now, underneath that, we still want to be efficient and look at media types and QLC with the introduction of QLC. And, you know, make sure that for whatever capacity point you want, we're going to have that best TCO for you.
So you're saying the next era is essentially preserving that simplicity, that operational excellence of HC that we saw with HCI, but then extending, addressing some of the problems that Rob was talking about, driving efficiency better for sort of emerging AI workloads. Is that part of the equation?
Yeah, I mean, potentially, like in the topic of AI, when you kind of think about sort of transactional or primary storage and so forth, there are some use cases depending upon like how you use your vector databases and so forth. So it's not to say that it's completely excluded. There's some use cases. Clearly, there's a lot more focus on the unstructured side for these big models and the training that has to go on. And look, we've got a sort of a hot tier of that training data, a cold tier of that training data. It's a really fast evolving space as well. But yeah, certainly a good reason to, if you are engaging in that type of activity, to again decouple that compute and storage, because you might be wanting to refresh that compute on a yearly basis, you know, storage maybe every 4 to 5.
But logically being able to manage it and with that simplicity, whereas again, you go back to the converged infrastructure, it was almost like you were bolting networking storage and servers on together. And it's like, here you go.
And this is where it's like the power of Dell Technologies. I like us being able to do that based upon what we can do across the breadth of our portfolio of the data center. We've clearly got the compute expertise. We've clearly got the storage expertise. We've got a lot of expertise in creating, some of the most successful HCI offers. You know, we've got the right DNA here to bring this together and deliver it.
Yeah, I mean, we were talking about it, and I think that, when you start to look at it, people want that cloud operating model, and we look at cloud as it's not a place, it's an operating model. Are you seeing people lean in, especially with the, I would say that the, not uncertainty, but the changing dynamics of the hypervisor layer, are people leaning into this more now? Because what they're looking for is that cloud operating model.
Yeah, absolutely. Leaning in is probably an understatement. I'd say, and I'll kind of hit on another aspect of my portfolio, is it was about a year, a little bit over a year ago, some of our larger customers that were using our PowerFlex software defined offering, were proactively reaching out to us and wanting to know, like, hey, so like, really like this PowerFlex solution, but like, we're looking for more hypervisor diversity here, and understandably so, which led to our engagement with Nutanix about kind of pulling Acropolis out of their stack and allowing us to use that with PowerFlex, which you know, we now have, you know, in market. So, yeah, I mean, so it's been a great, it's been an interesting period of time, and yeah, customers are absolutely leaning in.
Can you paint a picture for our audience of the portfolio? How's it lining up? What's new?
Yeah, sure. So maybe we'll cover the primary or transactional side of the portfolio. We've got our PowerMax system, which is our crown jewel in terms of mission critical storage, still out there, a very loyal customer base. We've got PowerStore, which is our enterprise class storage, which, like I said earlier, the broadest reach in terms of use cases, price points, performance, you know, spread that we can support on that side. And then we've got PowerFlex as our software defined offering, which, you know, frankly, we call it software defined storage, but really our customers use that to build out their own internal public clouds because it's very easy to scale out and it has that cloud operating model, even from an architectural point of view. And then on the unstructured side of the house, we've got our scale out file in PowerScale, and we've got our scale out object in ObjectScale. So lots of things going on in all of those. You know, PowerStore, you know, I talked about some of the efficiency, you know, story, which is still front and center of everything that we do there. But, you know, in addition, we had a release here just last month, and, you know, PowerStore is essentially powered by software. So, which means we're going to have this constant stream of capabilities that we're making available to our customers that they just need only upgrade to that version to take advantage of these things. So there's no, you know, net buy a new box kind of a model here. So, you know, areas that we just kind of addressed recently are, you know, really tapping into AI to make the operations and serviceability of these. So we have this thing called Smart Support now, which, you know, we use AI to correlate a bunch of data points that we're observing on a system that's operating, both on the hardware and the software side, to predict a failure before it happens. And so we're flagging customers to say, hey, we're noticing these trends. The correlation says you're likely going to have a problem here. We can even extend that to the point where we can proactively initiate a support request to dispatch a part. We're like, we feel confident enough that this thing is going to fail. The part's on the way. So huge step forward, but like it's just the beginning and what we can start to do with AI on these systems to bring forward a level of insight.
Because I think one of the things that you kind of hit on it a little bit there, which I think I said this back when we were talking about PowerStore previously, is it almost buries the lead, the fact that the upgradability and to be able to take it, you guys have done a lot of work under the hood. Maybe, you know, people that don't notice it per se, who are out there or maybe not a customer yet, but the upgradability has really improved as well. Your partners were talking about that. Talk about kind of that, because that to me is really key for people when they're looking at building their cloud operating model and being able to be serviceable and things of that nature.
Yeah, I mean, it's I call it investment protection, call it, you know, buying into the long-term benefits of the platform, right? No customer left behind. And look, this is even going to extend as we introduce like new generations of hardware. Like we're not going to like, you know, turn off capabilities, you know, going back in time. And this is one of the reasons why we made PowerStore. Actually, we don't talk about this a lot, but it's a scale up, you know, storage system, but it also has a scale out capability that we can cluster these things together. So when that next generation box comes out, we can put these things two together in a cluster, you know, decide where you want your volumes. But from a feature set perspective on either one, completely equivalent. So there's, you know, no penalty that you're paying for doing that upgrade. So yeah, very important. Customers don't want to be stranded on functionality or forced to, you know, buy the next box to get that next level of functionality.
So how does it work? I'm hearing there's certain software pushes that I can get that it can enhance performance or efficiency and that's there. And then at some point I've got to upgrade the hardware,
right.
but you've got licensing terms that allow me to do that in a non-disruptive way and buy into the future. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. And so, and let's say like you're really happy with that next generation hardware that comes out. Let's put these two in the same cluster. So I now have visibility to both of these as a single system. Why would I want to go do that? Because, well, that next generation of hardware, likely higher performance just based upon the way this sort of works as hardware gets refreshed. And I've got a higher IOPS or throughput capability on here. Let me look at the volumes on that current system. Where would I see the benefit most? Okay, these two applications, let's move those volumes over. And you know, now I've got a balanced system, but I'm taking advantage of the new hardware where I can. By the way, the previous box is still there doing its work, and you decide how you want to decommission that on your terms.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, excellent. I think that's part of it. And as people bring these new cloud native apps that are, you know, Kubernetes based or, you know, VMs and VMs and Kubernetes or container based, are you seeing that they're bringing a lot new workloads that have not necessarily traditionally, you talked about the three tier, but the three tiers, now it may be 25 tiers or microservice based and stuff like that. Is that changing the workloads you see on PowerStore as well?
Yeah, clearly. A steady growth in those microservices based, applications over time. You know, so we look at things like the kind of scalability metrics that we need to deliver to support those Kubernetes environments. Again, to your point, it's very not the way we looked at scalability in the past in terms of kind of like the sheer number of API calls that need to be supported to make these things work well. So absolutely, we're seeing that evolution. But, you know, at the same time, you don't want to buy a box only for that capability. And that's where we think like the flexibility that we have with something like a store in that disaggregated infrastructure model really plays to its strengths. Like I don't mean this to come off in the wrong way, but we don't care what's running on the host side.
Yeah.
Right. Like we just want to be there to serve you as best we can based upon what that is, giving you the ultimate flexibility that you have, not having like these bespoke infrastructure silos, like, you know, this is what I use for data analytics, and this is what I use for, you know, my high performance databases, right? Let's get out of that model.
Yeah, that is a model that we've been stuck in for a while now. And again, we come kind of back to where we started here. We've seen the evolution. I mean, the converged infrastructure piece was sort of short-lived. HCI had a good run. And now we're entering this sort of new phase where you're seeing renewed momentum in on-prem, no question about that. And it's not so much a repatriation trend, it's just there's a lot of data on-prem that people want to, you know, inject with intelligence, and they want to modernize that infrastructure. So I'll give you the last word. You know, how do you see this era sort of evolving?
Well, I mean, let me pivot off of the private hybrid cloud just to the Gen AI space just briefly. Like, it'd be hard to like not cover
this. Do,
yeah. Maybe I'll close with that. Is look at our clearly one of, you know, maybe the most disruptive workload we've seen come along to IT infrastructure in my lifetime.
Ever.
I don't think that's a hyperbole, no. Right? We firmly believe that the right answer for storage to support that generative AI is a multi-protocol, scalable, flexible, distributed system. And by multi-protocol, that means, we need really capable scale-out file. We need really capable scale-out object. So we've got a lot of investment and roadmap work going on there. On the PowerScale side for our file systems, you know, launching a 122 terabyte drive, which puts us in a position that we can say literally we are the densest, file storage system in the market. So like most terabytes per rack unit, hands down at this point in time. But that's for the hot tier. There's also, we're seeing like this, I'll call it a cold tier of generative AI. Like, okay, there's some interesting data here. I may want this for a model later. And so we're refreshing our hard drive based PowerScale models as well. So we have a good economic point on that, and supporting some better latency through some, SSD cache to drive ratios and so forth. And then on the objects side, we've launched object scale. So built upon the foundations that we have in ECS as our object platform for a long time, but built in a way that it's ready for this era of AI. So scalable, performant, adding the same sort of high density drives that we have on scale to hit these density points that are becoming, really critical, especially as you talk about service provider opportunities that we want to participate in. These are won or lost based upon literally like how many terabytes can I fit in a square inch at this point in time. So we're excited about what's going on there as well. So between the cloud and Gen AI, it's a really exciting time to be here.
Well, Jared, thanks so much for spending some time with us. I really appreciate it.
Always.
Thank you. All right, Dave Vellante for Rob Strechay. Keep it right there. We're back for more action from Round Rock 2. Watch theCUBE.